Here are a few of the most horrific invasive species on Earth. Number 6. Snakehead Fish. A fish with shark-like teeth and the ability to walk on land probably sounds like the things of nightmares. But the northern snakehead is all too real. Just ask Maryland natives who discovered the fish in a pond in 2002 when they quickly annihilated the other species in the pond. Native to Asia and Africa, snakeheads have spread to waters all over the globe over the past century. This is bad because when they're introduced to unnatural habitats, they have no natural predator and basically have free rein to eat whatever they feel like, which can really throw the ecosystem out of order. Dubbed Fishzilla by National Geographic, this freak-like fish can survive on land for up to 4 days, and the average female can produce about 150,000 offspring during her life, making the population impossible to control. The fish were legally imported into the States to display in aquariums and to eat since they look kinda cool and they're considered a popular dish in Asia. But their presence has really disrupted fishing trades as their population has spread all across the Potomac River system. They've even been spotted in Florida, North Carolina, California, Hawaii, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts. So you can see why a fisherman in the Americas might hate these things so much. That's why it's now illegal to own live snakeheads in most US states who consider them to be a destructive, invasive species. The real question is, how has there not been a really bad B-movie made about this? If Sharknado gets 5 movies, why hasn't there been a film called The Invasion of Fishzilla? Fish that can live on land, bite the crap out of you, and mess up your ecosystem? Come on, let's make that happen. Number 5. The Cane Toad. Although the cane toad is native to the Americas, it has spread across island nations in the Caribbean and Oceania, and has even managed to weasel its way up into northern Australia. By no stretch of the definition is this an awesome thing. As an invasive species, cane toads often wreak havoc on native species when they are first introduced to a new ecosystem. In the more than 20 countries the cane toad has invaded, many of the countries saw a pretty serious decline in biodiversity. In Australia, for example, after these pesky toads moved on in, the population of northern quolls, which is a tiny little creature that roams the Northern Territory of Australia, were greatly reduced. They've been in rapid decline thanks to the cane toads invading their territory and are currently classified as an endangered species. Merton's water monitors, a small lizard that calls Australia home, have also seen a huge decline in their ranks thanks to these annoying toads. Cane toads were introduced to Australia from Hawaii in June 1935 in an attempt to control the native grey-backed cane beetle and Frenchie beetle. These beetles are native to Australia and they're detrimental to sugarcane crops, which are a major source of income for Australia. Cane toads were to replace the use of pesticides such as arsenic and copper. The cane toads bred immediately in captivity, and by August 1935, more than 102 young toads were released. Since their release, the toads have rapidly multiplied in population and now number over 200 million and have been known to spread diseases affecting local biodiversity. Unfortunately, the introduction of the toads has not only caused large environmental detriment, but the toads didn't do much to stop the beetles, but instead just became pests themselves. Let's just say it didn't work out too well, to say the least. Number 4. European Starling. While Alfred Hitchcock got some people really freaked out by birds on the surface, an army of songbirds doesn't really sound all that bad, which is probably why Eugene Schefflin figured he'd release 60 of them into Central Park in 1890. As their name would suggest, they're native to Europe, not the US. A drug manufacturer and literary fanatic, Schefflin figured he'd introduce every bird mentioned in Shakespeare's work to North America. Can I get some of whatever this guy was smoking? Anyways, thanks to a very brief mention of the bird in Henry VI, the 60 European starlings that were first let loose in Central Park have ballooned into 150 million. 60 to 150 million in around 120 years? Wow! European starlings have gone on to cause upwards of $800 million in crop damage each year. Of course, the intentions here were pretty innocent. I mean, many people have found weird ways to pay homage to their favorite artists, and unless you're a biology expert or something, how would you know that they would grow like that? and their population is spread all over the world. That's something like 310 million. European starlings had been imported to different areas because of their ability to control pests, pollinate crops, and perform a handful of other functions. However, when introduced to a new ecosystem, European starlings can cause pandemonium. Common starlings can eat and damage fruit in orchards such as grapes, peaches, and olives. They may also eat animal feed and distribute seeds throughout their droppings. In eastern Australia, weeds such as bridle creeper, blackberry, and bone seed are thought to have been spread by common starlings. Starlings' droppings can contain a fungus which causes histoplasmosis in humans, which is a type of lung infection. At roosting sites, this fungus can thrive in accumulated droppings. There are a number of other infectious diseases that can potentially be transmitted by common starlings to humans. The large size of flocks can also cause problems. Common starlings may be sucked into aircraft jet engines. One of the worst instances of this being an incident in Boston in 1960 when 62 people died after a turboprop airliner flew into a flock and plummeted into the sea at Winthrop Harbor. So, yeah, these guys can for sure be a pretty serious problem. Number 3, Burmese python. They're one of the largest snakes on the planet, sometimes reaching an astonishing 18 feet in length. Armed with razor-sharp teeth and the ability to suffocate large prey such as deer, pigs, and goats, pythons are pretty damn scary. Because their population has skyrocketed in the Florida Everglades, Burmese pythons are considered to be an invasive species. By some estimates, more than 1,300 of these giant snakes roam the woods of Florida. Initially, they were sold to Americans as exotic pets, but because they're often released into the wild, their population has grown incredibly large. In 2012, the U.S. Department of the Interior banned the importation of Burmese pythons because of the devastating effect they've been having on South Florida's ecosystem. For example, in Florida, they're known to be opportunistic predators, often wrangling up foxes, rabbits, possum, white-tailed deer, panther, and raccoons. Without a predator to keep them in check, they treat the Everglades as their own personal buffet. And all of these populations are thought to have been dramatically impacted by the snake's presence in Florida. Since they're native to parts of Southeast Asia, as they're having the name Burmese, and the name would suggest, they can only survive in climates similar to that. That's why they have been thriving in Florida. So while it's unlikely that they'll spread across the US, they're still causing mayhem in Florida. Here's the thing about redback spiders. On top of being really invasive, they're also super poisonous, which really isn't a great combination. Their painful bite has earned them a fearsome reputation in Australia, where natives consider them to be among the most dangerous of spiders. During the 1980s, Brisbane noticed a huge influx of these dangerous spiders. Redbacks are known to prefer a dry climate, which is weird because Brisbane sports a pretty moist subtropical climate. But the 80s saw a more dry climate in Brisbane, which allowed the redback population to grow tremendously. This was a problem because redbacks prefer to live where humans do. The garden, the woodshed, the attic, the basement, windowsills, patio furniture, you name it, and redbacks probably will try to make it their home. And the problem seems to be a recurring one, as Brisbane and really Queensland as a whole is currently experiencing another outbreak of redbacks. The intense summer heat wave is likely the cause of the population explosion, much to the chagrin of Brisbane natives. These guys bite around 2,000 people each year. Their bites can really screw up your day if you're unlucky enough to be attacked. The weird thing is, the bites often go unnoticed at first, which is bad because that allows the venom to spread. Eventually, the pain becomes really intense, which often disrupts anyone's day-to-day activities. Nausea, vomiting, headaches, and lethargy are staple side effects of a redback bite. Though not typically fatal, there was recently an extreme case. The Burley family, for instance, they tragically lost their 22-year-old son Jaden to a redback bite in April of 2016. Jaden landed in the hospital after being bitten by a spider and was released 4 days later with antibiotics. However, an abscess had formed under his arm, which infected his glands. That's what was believed to have killed him 2 days later after leaving the hospital. To make matters worse, Jane's 17-year-old brother had been killed 8 months earlier in a car wreck. Ah, talk about tragedy. As awful as his death was, Jaden is the first person to die from such a bite in more than 60 years. Ever since the introduction of an effective anti-venom, most people have been able to survive the bites. Redback spiders even seem to be spreading outside of Australia. In 2014, redbacks were found in Tokyo for the first time ever. This could have been pretty awful since Japan wasn't ready to treat an outbreak in bites. While this invasion didn't seem to lead to any real problems, it does prove troublesome. Who knows where they may end up next? With the influx of redbacks, it seems likely that there will be more and more spider bites. The BBC reported that a man was bitten on the penis by one of the annoying spiders when he was using a portable bathroom. I think that's on any guy's list of worst things that can happen. As god-awful as that was, he survived the ordeal after going to the hospital. Though he was reported to experience lots of sweating, vomiting, and nausea, he was later released in stable condition with hopefully fully functioning equipment and, I assume, a newfound appreciation for antivenom. Number 1. Black Rats. Since black rats were thought to be an accomplice in the spread of the Black Death, which killed around 100 million people in Europe during the 14th century, one could argue they're among the worst invasive species of all time. In fact, they may just take the cake. One of the more widely accepted theories as to how the Black Death, or also known as the bubonic plague, spread was that fleas carrying the plague latched onto black rats, who were pretty common on merchant ships, and helped spread the plague all across Europe. We've all heard about the Black Death, and we know that it wiped out a huge portion of the world's population. It wasn't until the 17th century and the Industrial Revolution that the population recovered. But what was the plague actually like? I have no clue, but I can only guess that it sucked. Those infected would grow buboes, which caused lymph nodes to swell up, sometimes to the size of apples, according to historical accounts. These buboes would often ooze, pus, and bleed when they popped or opened. Black spots would form all over the body, which was likely the result of dead flesh, hence the name Black Death. People would then develop really bad fevers and start vomiting blood. In most cases, those infected wouldn't last even a week. At the time, they figured the plague was spread airborne. They thought it was simply bad air. The concept of hygiene was a pretty foreign concept, which is why most cities had discarded food, trash, and piles of human sh** all over the city. This made it a ripe breeding ground for the rats who came over on merchant ships who carried over the fleas, which then caused the plague to spread like wildfire. Now, some historians have presented some pretty lucid evidence to suggest that the plague was actually spread person to person and not by rats. Even if that is the case, and who knows if it is, black rats are still considered to be a pest to this day. Like pretty much all other invasive species, they invade an ecosystem and royally f*** up. Rats have been especially destructive on subarctic tropical islands. Without a natural predator, they grow uncontrollably and prey on other species, and are responsible for the extinction of many species on tropical islands. Seriously, who likes rats? Here's what's next. Heard of any of these? Let us know in the comments. Reportedly, a goat with 7 legs has been born in Jiaoliao Township, Tainan, Jilin Province in China. The owner of the goat, a woman surnamed Song, explained that it was a difficult birth, but the goat is standing.